Hey everybody, CVH here, bringing you another deck tech for BetweenLanes.net. If you're on the YouTube page, be sure to check out BetweenLanes.net to find more strategy articles and more deck techs. And if you're on BetweenLanes.net, well, you're already here, but check out the YouTube channel to see more non-particularly strategy content, other stream highlights, etc. Anyway, on topic, the deck tech I have for you guys today is the Control Mage deck that's getting a good amount of attention when I stream. People ask for the list a lot and want to see some analysis on it, I guess. It's been pretty good for me. Got a positive win rate so far in Legend, maintaining top 20-ish with it. And it's one of the few decks that I think I've had a positive win rate against the Archer midrange, the very popular red-green deck on the ladder with. Even at high Legend, it's been definitely more than 50%. Can lose to it still, as all decks can, but this is one of the decks that I think is a better matchup to it. So basically, this is unlike the Aggro Mage deck, even though it has the same attributes that make up the class Mage. Intelligence and willpower. It's very different besides that. It has it's definitely not as budget friendly with a lot of the more expensive legendaries, high value cards, as we can see down here. And basically in just the general game plan, this deck is not aggressive at all. It wants to stall the game as much as possible, remove opposing threats and creatures, basically fight for the board early, and not even use that to press any sort of aggression unless it has just all the advantage already, but just stall, remove the board repeatedly, and get to these high value cards that can even end the game in one or two turns if you need it to go that long and you're that scared of getting opponents giving them additional cards depending on the matchup. So as usual, I'll just go up the curve and explain the card choices. Brutal Ashlander, it's in the Aggro Mage deck too, but it serves a different purpose in this deck. This is just to combat other aggressive cards. Occasionally it can 2-for-1 if you can trade with something with 1 health, and then the last gasp will kill something else. Unlike in the Aggro Mage deck, we are not happy when this goes face in this deck. Very rarely, I should say. I mean, sometimes, but not commonly. You really want it to hit another creature. Firebolt, solid removal action, and it's worth noting that we're not using Execute in this deck. As of right now, I'm not finding a lot of times when Execute would be better than the Firebolt, and we also have the Cunning Allies, which we need to sort of be concerned about in deck building. But I mean, Execute's definitely a card that could be included in the future, depending on what you're playing against. Definitely a meta call there. Healing Potion might look a little sketchy if you're not used to seeing what a control deck looks like. It, on the surface, just looks like a negative in card advantage. You're just giving up a card and only gaining life, which isn't really like a tangible resource or anything. But it does keep you alive, which is kind of the whole point. You want to be able to play high-value cards, which is, yeah, you know, that's just true, but you also want to be able to live in order to play them. You're not going to get to these very late-game turns without something to stave off the aggression that, like, red-green, obviously the Archer deck can get you down really fast, but even if you stabilize on board, it has ways to keep putting threats out there, and even if you put up guards, like, in one lane, you can charge in the other lane. The blue-red deck with all the items and the charge guys, that'll get in there and just burn you down. Even the Aggro Mage, even if you stabilize on board, doesn't have any charge guys, but it can just burn you out with cards like Crushing Blow, Lightning Bolt. Sometimes you just really need a heal for 5, that's why this card's in there, and it's a 3 of in a 50 card deck. Sometimes you just, when you really need one, you really need one, and then you probably can win if you just have that 5 extra life. Shimmering Peddler, it also could be a 3 of potentially, depending on how you build the deck, and if you really need another 2 drop, there's other 2 drops to consider as well. This card's been surprisingly good for me actually, even in a deck that has a fair amount of, you know, creatures and supports, well, at least one support, you know what I mean. It does get its cycle effect off with a pretty high consistency, and when you don't need the cycle effect, it's just a 2-for-2-2, and it'll more than likely force your opponent to kill it, even if they're an aggressive deck and want to be hitting face. They don't really want you to get extra cards either. Sometimes they can, you know, have an awkward attack or something that you can force with this card. Crushing Blow, solid removal. This deck's all about solid removal, getting to the late game, so we play this card. And of course, with the Lightning Bolts, you do have a fair amount of reach if you really need some burst damage. You built up a force of giant creatures and you're going in for game, but you don't have quite enough. These cards can also get you there, so it adds some versatility. Cunning Ally, definitely a fine card. Gives you solid removal, gives you something to trade with early game. That's why we play it. Also exactly why we play Telvanni Arcanist. It's a little more RNG dependent, but it can lead to some pretty crazy turns that your opponents aren't expecting. It does trade slightly worse, though, because it's a 3-2 instead of a 3-3. Worth noting. So, Aridon Paladin, which I'm pretty sure I'm not pronouncing correctly, very much exceeded my expectations. In fact, I've actually considered a third copy of it. I really underestimated how much I would need the life gain, even though I was running the max copies of Healing Potion. Also worth noting that this deck is loosely based on Chapter House's list. I did change a few things, but not as much as I've changed in other decks, and I've played this a lot on the Legend Ladder, so he did run the 2 copies. I'm considering upping it to 3, depending on what I'm up against. It seems like there's a lot of aggression on the ladder currently. And your deck's chock full of actions, so I mean, if this sticks for a turn, you're very likely to just get the drain effect off. It's almost never that you don't. And a 4-drop, which is a 4-4, can trade with a good amount of things. It trades with Soulrest Marshal and Jarl. These are pretty common cards to see on the ladder. Elusive Schemer. It's very weak as far as health is concerned, but it can trade with those high-value cards as well. And Cycle in the late game against other control decks is a premium. You can often find the copies that cost zero if you've played a couple of these throughout the game. Games against the non-very fast aggressive decks and some of the mid-range decks, games against decks that aren't those, they tend to go pretty long. So it's very common that this card can put you ahead in just general board, because like you're playing 4-1s that cost zero and Cycle, your opponent still has to deal with them. That's a lot of damage if they just let it stick. Firestorm, good against the token decks and the aggressive decks. Basically all I have to say about that card. Hive Defender is fantastic against those decks, and basically just a good turn 4 play whenever. This is a card I would keep in my opening hand basically every time I have the Elixir, and if I have anything to play early, I can just keep a Hive Defender. It's like, I will want this card on turn 4 even more often than I'll want like Elusive Schemer or the Paladin. Hive Defender is just very solid. Even though it doesn't like initially trade with a 4-4, you can easily finish off that damage somewhere. Lightning Bolt, already really talked about this card in every deck that plays blue right now. I think should be playing 3. It's just a very solid card. And for this deck that wants to kill things, it's premium. Vicious Dreg, which I'm also pretty sure I'm mispronouncing. Don't really know the lore, guys. If you haven't seen me talk about that in my stream, that's just a fact. But this card is great. So all the aggressive decks, except for maybe many of the very aggressive decks like that run red will be running those supports that give your guys, they give things, there's an elixir that gives something like plus something and breakthrough. There's one that gives all your fire, or all your red guys plus one attack. Clearly I don't know the names of the cards too well in the aggressive decks that I haven't played yet, but this is a solid answer to both of those. Against anything that's late game that looks like it could be running Goldbrand, you're even more likely to be able to save this, because against a late game deck you're not really having to put things on the board just to trade. So you'd be like, alright, I'll just save this card, and if they play a Goldbrand I can get sick value out of it. The Orb that draws in cards, Mundustone, Divine Fervor in any of the aggressive yellow decks, just absolutely insane to get rid of that. So this card can really swing you games, and I think you definitely want to have two copies in here. It's worth noting that I didn't need it in the Sorcerer deck I previewed, because there was that purple guy that does basically the same thing while being able to silence something. Eren is one of the first legendary we are discussing. While this card isn't like a key to the deck in that it's not like central to the strategy or anything, it's just such a high value card, there's no real reason not to play it. A 5-drop 5-5 is kind of perfect for this deck that doesn't really have other 5 Magicka cards to play. You're just getting a random action from your discard pile, which is usually, if you're playing it on curve, you know, Firebolt, Crushing Blow, or more than likely Lightning Bolt, and everything costs one less. So if you've only played a Firebolt, you can just, you know, get a Firebolt back on turn 5, play it for free on something. That's a play that happens quite a lot. If it's later in the game, you could even get back something like an Ice Storm, or another Sweeper if you really need to. And if it sticks, of course, they run the risk of you playing a bunch of stuff that you wouldn't normally be able to play. It's not usually that insane, you have like 2 or 3 actions in your hand, but that can be enough to like squeeze in an extra minion drop or something. Just getting the spell back by itself is honestly enough value. Piercing Javelin, fantastic card, absolutely everything this deck wants to have in an action, so we play it as a 3 of. Ice Storm is a 2 of because it's slightly less needed. You only really need it against the decks that spam the board with a bunch of things with 3 or less health. Sometimes it helps you trade up against, you know, bigger threats, but more than likely it's just good against those decks. But when it is good, it is very good. Also worth noting that this deck's not running currently. Gotta click my button. Dawn's Wrath. I haven't crafted this card to test it yet, but I fully intend to. I feel like, on the whole, when you want a sweeper, Ice Storm is better against a lot of those decks than Dawn's Wrath. There's few, like, if you're fearing against a control deck where Ice Storm is not good, they're probably not playing enough threats for Dawn's Wrath to be significantly better than a Piercing Javelin. But if you're up against a deck that really needs a sweeper, even though Dawn's Wrath could potentially kill one more thing, it's often not worth the fact that Ice Storm can spread across both lanes and also costs 2 Magicka less. So, you know, sometimes you just die before turn 8, guys. It happens. Even with this deck, occasionally. But Ice Storm's been really solid. I definitely wouldn't take out this card for Dawn's Wrath, but there could be room somewhere else for sure if you want to test that card. It's definitely, if I had to pick one other card that's not on the list, it would be Dawn's Wrath and, like, Execute. You can test those cards. Probably both very good in the deck as well. Senshi Tiger? Another insane guard, much like Hive Defender. Comes down later, so we don't run the full 3 of, but as far as 6-drop goes, this is everything the deck wants. Perfect to stall the board. The fact that you have a good amount of guards in this deck can really give you that safety net in the late game when maybe your life isn't as high as you want and you still need to draw a healing potion or the paladin. And you just need time to get to those cards, and sometimes these can just give you enough time to get there. Goldbrand, very high value support. Everything this deck would want in the support. It has 12 damage over 3 turns. If they don't play something like the Vicious Dreg, you're going to get there and deal a lot of damage with it. Helps you stabilize over the course of 3 turns. Sometimes a little slow if you've already lost control of the board. That's really the only downside of the card, though. I'm going to skip over the Atromancer really quick and talk about the cards. Let's talk about the Atromancer. It's not really like a guaranteed inclusion in a control deck. It's because it deals damage, and you don't always want to be giving your opponents runes if you're just trying to stabilize, build a giant board, and then finally hit them. I like it though because this deck has a lot of really good like 1-for-1 removal, a lot of really good, you know, creatures that it can play that are just like big bodies by themselves, like we're about to talk about. But sometimes you just need something to like get ahead in those stalemate situations, and Atromancer is one of the few things that can really put a huge pressure on the board with just one card. Like, a lot of these have like good value, but it's not really going to apply a lot of pressure by itself. Atromancer can sort of set you up to end the game in one or two turns if that's the thing you need. Against an aggressive deck, yeah, it might not always be the most fantastic legendary to have, but I think it's worth the spot just for that. Double Mana Core as opposed to 3, it's a very overcosted, not overcosted for its value, but it's high-costed compared to, you know, things you want in your opening hand, and you will open with some of these occasionally, you just have to get used to that. But 10 drop, 6-6 guard, destroy an enemy creature. If you're paying 5 for a Javelin, then you're paying 4 extra for 6-6 and guard, and of course it doesn't have Prophecy, but that's a lot. Sometimes you really don't think you're going to need to destroy a creature and also put a guard out. But sometimes you do, and when you don't have Hive Defender plus Piercing Javelin, which is 2 cards, the Mana Core is a very consistent way to get that on the board, and that play alone is enough to stabilize you a lot of the time. The Fear I'm testing out, this is actually one of the newer cards in my list. When it deals 6 damage to a random enemy, obviously that's sort of like the Atromancer when you don't really want it to go face a lot, but this can be a very strong removal option, and in a control deck, in a control mirror match per se, they really need to have an answer to it immediately, because that extra 6-6 that it's going to summon at the beginning of your next turn, that's, you know, it's like the Atromancer. It can just sort of get out of control very fast, and then, you know, your opponent just dies all of a sudden if they just use their removal on a Tiger or something that they shouldn't have used the Javelin on, and then all of a sudden they can't deal with this and they lose. Mirok, it's a threat by itself, sort of as a 5-5, and it steals an enemy threat. If you save this for the right card, like maybe an Odaving, it can just be insane when you think that you're getting rid of a 12 magicka card, and you're gaining basically a 12 magicka card on your board. So while it is very overcosted compared to like the Javelin and Mana Core, the potential upside in a control mirror match, or like against a mid-range deck that really plays like one big threat that turn, like a Tazcat, is just huge. Against Dagger, obviously this card is not really what you want to be playing. Very rarely are you really excited to see this card in your hand against aggro, but it's very good in the matchups it's good in. And last card, of course, is Odaving. We just talked about how good it is to steal. Let's talk about how good it is to play. It adds another sweeper to the deck in addition to the Firestorms and the Ice Storms. 10-10 body is just, you know, that's another game ender. You play it, and even though it's like a one card thing they can Javelin, if it lives, they're probably going to lose. And if you're playing it against the right deck, they're probably just going to lose their entire board, so even if it dies, you're totally fine with it, and you can just wait to draw another threat because you've given yourself so much extra time. I think the card is a pretty much instant inclusion in any sort of ramp or control deck currently. Waiting to be proved wrong, but I think the card is just very good. I'm not going to say it's broken or anything, because I don't think a 12 Magicka card can be, but the card is just very good, and what this deck wants to do, if it wants to do anything at turn 12. And it's going to get to turn 12 if you're winning, more than likely. So that's basically the deck. Hope you enjoyed it. Check out my stream in the... check out my Twitter on the screen, but check out my stream. I'll link it in the description at IMCVH for some gameplay. I'll be posting some more games with this deck on YouTube as well. Check out BetweenTheLanes.net, and I'll see you for more deck techs and more strategy articles.